League of Stars. Whoa.
Sorry, Janari. Sorry, Janari.
What's up, everybody? It's the Alex Leek and Friends NFL Podcast, back for another week. I'm your host, Alex Leek. It's the 2018 NFL season going into week 15. I got a couple guests here. I got Adam.
What's going on?
And I got Tito.
Hey, how's it going?
And we're going to break down the week. A lot of good football, a lot of exciting action. And let's start it out. Let's go to Thursday night with the Jags. Go to Nissan Stadium and beat up the Titans. Demolish the Jags 30-9 in Nissan Stadium to stay alive in the playoff hunt. Derrick Henry absolutely goes off, rushes for a Titans record 238 yards and 4 touchdowns, including a 99-yard rushing touchdown that ties for the longest rushing touchdown in NFL history with Cowboys running back Tony Dorsett in 1983. Adam, what were your thoughts on a Titans blowout on Thursday night?
Yeah, kind of a little crazy, but at the same time, a little expected. This is what's become kind of the norm for road teams going on Thursday night. It just seems like they're always at a big disadvantage. Obviously, Jacksonville has not been playing well. They got their first win, I think it was last week, and they lost 7 straight. So they're just not playing well these days. And in the meanwhile, Tennessee's been playing better. And the defense for Jacksonville just really been struggling, even though, they give up a lot of points. Actually, they haven't been giving up, I don't think they've been giving up too many yards, but those Thursday night games are just tough for road teams.
Yeah, it's weird how that works. Tito, what's your thought on this? The Jags, I mean, they were so good last year, AFC Championship, such an intimidating defense. This year, they just can't seem to put it together and get blown out again here. What are your thoughts on the Jags?
Yeah, it's kind of surprising. Like you mentioned, last year they're going to the they did really well. Then this year they can't muster any wins. I was really surprised they didn't update, or upgrade at the quarterback.
Yeah.
And then obviously they benched Bowles, and then now they got Cody Kessler, and that's not really going to do much for your offense. And Leonard Fournette hasn't been the same player. He's been injured. And that defense, I'm surprised that the defense hasn't held up. I don't know if they did too much trash talking and they got to their head, but they just haven't been the same. And so, yeah, it's quite surprising to see how far they've fallen since last year.
Yeah, it is surprising. And like you said, the trash talk, and Jalen Ramsey sure has been talking a lot all offseason, all season long, and it just hasn't worked out. I think he's a great talent, but maybe you should chill on the trash talk until the team gets good. Adam, what's your take? There's a quote, growing perception, that according to CBS Sports, Jason Lockenfora says there's, quote, growing perception that Tom Coughlin could step in and be the team's head coach in 2019. You think that would be a good idea for the Jags? Doug Marrone's almost certainly fired at the end of the year.
I guess I wouldn't be surprised if it happened. I don't know if that's the key or going to be the fix or not. Doug Marrone was coaching them last year,
mm-hmm.
and they did go to the AFC Championship game. I don't know. I just kind of feel like maybe it's – I think they bought too much into their own Kool-Aid. They decided they were a great team and that the Patriots were lucky to have beaten them in the AFC Championship game, and they got too high on themselves, and now they're coming back to earth a little bit this year. Coughlin coming in might help that. He is kind of known for his disciplinarian, so that may help, but it's hard to tell.
Do you think it's as simple as a quarterback problem in Jacksonville, or do you think there's some bigger issues?
Well, that's definitely a big start. I mean, no team is going to be successful in the NFL without a good quarterback.
Yeah.
So that's obviously a problem. You're not going to – I've been kind of a – I mean, I've not been a huge Blake Bortles fan, but I've been more of a Blake Bortles supporter, and I thought he was a little better than people gave him credit for. But Cody Kessler is clearly not going to be the answer either, so they have to address that, I think, before anything else.
Yeah, and I agree with you. I think the better question is not is he a good quarterback or not. It's just getting consistent quarterback play that you can rely on. The turnovers are definitely killer. Tito, do you think that – what would you do if you were in the Jags position? Would you – obviously, you'd move on from Bortles. Who do you think would be a good fit there?
Oh, that's a great question. They're probably going to have to pick up a quarterback in the draft, and I'm not sure that even that will help them elevate their game to next year.
And
I'm not quite sure, to be honest, what quarterback they could pick up in free agency that will really help the team. You know, and other than that, I mean, they don't have the best receivers either. So they're still struggling.
You think a guy like Nick Foles could come in and help the team and do better than Bortles?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely, that is a good name to throw out there. He would be definitely an upgrade, and he would help the team a lot more. And even having Nick Foles in the back, I mean, he moves around well, he passes it well. Mm-hmm. That would put some, that would scare the defense on the opposing team a little more, as opposed to when you have Blake Bortles out there. Even Jacksonville is scared of having him back there, right? So having them back there, you're not putting fear into anybody other than yourself. So Nick Foles is a good name to throw out there. I think that would help them. And like you mentioned earlier, with Coughlin coming back, I mean, I think the Manning era is over in New York. Who knows? He might be a name that, gets thrown into the mix and mm-hmm. says, okay, maybe if that defense comes back, if they get a few good receivers, who knows? Maybe Eli Manning could be a name that could be lined up at quarterback for the Jacksonville Jaguars next year.
Yeah, absolutely. I've been trying to get that to happen for a couple of years now, but we'll see. The Giants don't really seem to want to get rid of him. We'll see if they do it this offseason. The Titans will look to stay in the playoff hunt in Week 15 at the Giants. Let's go to Sunday. We're going to start this off with, in my opinion, the game of the week. Sunday, the Baltimore Ravens at the Kansas City Chiefs. This game and this coming week are really the two most important games of the year for the Chiefs and the toughest test for Mahomes to date. So I'm really interested in watching Mahomes in these two games. And to me, Mahomes really stood out in that Baltimore game. This was the toughest defense he's played, and he just looked great. He made, I'll talk about some throws he made here. A 3rd and 19 pass play to Tyreek Hill for a first down earlier in the game. A no-look pass into coverage for a first down. A sidearm throw between two defenders to the running back, baseball style. Then on a 4th and 9, down 7 with a minute 29 to go in the game, Mahomes makes an unbelievable, he's being chased to his right, throws 35 plus yards, and picks up, on a 4th and 9, a must-have play. Mahomes really impressed me in this game. Adam, what's your take on Mahomes, especially in this game?
Yeah, I think a lot of people thought with this game that Mahomes put himself in the driver's seat to win the MVP for this year. He just looks, in control. Baltimore is a fantastic defense. They are, I think, rated number one in total yards allowed per game, and he just even if he gets off to a rough start in some of these games, he always self-adjusts, which is so impressive for someone that is still in their first year of being a full-time starter.
Absolutely.
So he I don't know if he just doesn't get nervous, or he's always calm, cool, collected. People in his face, he escapes, always looking downfield, always finds that open receiver, makes some pretty crazy throws on the run. So, he's just very impressive.
Yeah, and I've been kind of trying to pump the brakes on Mahomes and being like, well, He's still very young. Let's see what he does against the best defenses in football. And sitting down and watching this entire game on Sunday really showed me a lot. And I'm starting to buy, I mean, you gotta buy Mahomes after that performance, some of the plays he made. Tito, what's your take on Mahomes?
Yeah, wow, he's very impressive. And like you, I didn't really want to like him.
Yeah.
I didn't want to cheer for him. You know, I'm a Raiders fan, and, you know, this is in our division. You know, the Chiefs are in our division, and having to play him, it's going to seem for years now, is going to be terrible. He looks like a much better Aaron Rodgers. And when you have weapons like Tyreek Hill, Travis Kelce, who can go out there and just make plays, he's got everything that he needs to be successful. So Mahomes is looking like, in my opinion, the MVP of the season this year. And like you mentioned, some of the plays that he makes on the run are just incredible. It looks like he's playing Madden out there.
It's crazy.
Yeah, no, so I didn't want to buy the Kool-Aid, but I watched a lot of the Ravens Kansas City game. He's impressive. He's very impressive.
Yeah, the in my opinion, the Ravens had him beat maybe two or three times, and Mahomes just found a way to bring him back into it and get the job done. It was very impressive. One thing about the Chiefs, Mahomes has all that talent. He's got Kelce, Tyreek Hill, all those guys. I think that losing Kareem Hunt is a bigger loss than some people are giving him credit for. And I think that you saw that in this Ravens game, and I think you'll see it going forward, that games that they used to and could blow out and win easily are going to be tougher, and they're going to be a little bit more one-sided on offense. Do you agree with that, Adam?
I definitely agree with that. I actually had some big reservations on if they'd be able to keep the train going once they released Kareem Hunt.
Yeah.
He's such a big part of their offense, but so far they haven't really missed a beat too much. I mean, obviously you're going to have to rework some things and have other guys step up, which, you know, they've been able to do. But, when you're getting into the late season, into the playoffs, when you're playing a team like New England or Pittsburgh or the Chargers, you know, you're going to have all your guys stepping up big when you don't have that security blanket there or that quick release for Mahomes to get to.
Yeah, and
yeah,
I agree with that. You agree with that, Tito?
Oh yeah, definitely. They're it looks like even in this game they're going to have to get creative in how they're going to run the ball. And it looks like Mahomes he's having to be a little more creative, you know, run around a little bit in the pocket because they're not going to be able to just hand off and create big runs like that Kareem Hunt would create, right? And so, yeah, they're going to have to get creative in how they're going to run the ball, especially against better teams and better defenses.
Yeah, absolutely. And everyone's talking about the Chiefs don't have any defense, but when it comes down to it in the clutch, you see linebacker Justin Houston making a big play in this game, a strip sack fumble recovery, setting the Chiefs up for a potential game-winning field goal late. Let's see here. The game should have been over in regulation, but the Chiefs kicker Harrison Butker couldn't miss a 43-yard field goal. In the end, though, the Chiefs pass rush gets the job done, knocks Lamar Jackson out of the game, and forces backup RG3 to try to get the job done, but he turns it over on downs. Huge win for the Chiefs. What's your take, Adam? What do you think of Lamar Jackson? He's out to a 3-1 start as a starter, and he's just been named, John Harbaugh names him the starter going forward, even with Flacco back. What's your feelings on Lamar Jackson?
He's playing really well. Obviously, he's still got a long way to go, but you have to kind of ride the wave right now. They're 3-1 with him. You have to keep him in, you know. And back in the day, they used to say, you know, you don't lose your starting job, you know, with an injury. But that happens constantly now. You know, if you have a guy that's playing in your absence, you know, unless you're Tom Brady or, you know, Aaron Rodgers or someone, you're getting the job back, or you're not getting the job back. So, as of right now, they have to ride the wave, let Lamar Jackson do his thing, and I don't think they've been terribly impressed by Joe Flacco anyway. So,
true.
I've never really been a Joe Flacco guy. So, you know, for me, I would definitely stick with Lamar Jackson.
Yeah, Tito, do you think the Ravens, do they scare you at all? Do you think they're a team that can get into the playoffs and make some noise? Or do you think that they're just an average team? I mean, they got a great defense, but do you trust Lamar Jackson in that offense?
Yeah, I think they could make some noise. I think I would trust the Ravens right now more than I would trust the Steelers. Lamar Jackson, even though his passing is improving every game, he's a dual threat, and you know, you have to take into account that he's going to run. I think this last game versus the Chiefs, he had 67 rushing yards. He had 147 passing yards. So, you know, having him back there, it opens up the field so much more, because you can spread the field. He'll take off running, and if you have too many men in the box, then he'll find Michael Crabtree and get some fields, some yards on the field in the passing game. So I do think the Ravens are a team that you're gonna have to be worried about, because that defense is gonna keep the Ravens in the game. It's gonna keep the game close like it did with the Chiefs. And you know, if it weren't for him getting hurt, who knows? Maybe they do come back, tie the game. Maybe they get another, get a tie, or maybe they do get a touchdown. So I think with having that defense, that's going to keep you in the game, they're definitely going to have a chance. They're definitely going to scare some teams come playoff time.
Yeah, that's a very good point. Having that defense kind of allows them room for error with a young quarterback like Lamar Jackson. So we'll see what they do, if they can get into January. The Ravens will look to stay in the playoff hunt in Week 15 with a game at home against the Tampa Bay Bucks. Let's go to the Falcons at the Packers, where the Packers take care of the Falcons 34-20 in Lambeau Field. They win their first game under interim head coach Joe Philbin and snap a three-game losing streak. Tito, the Packers looked impressive here, but let's go back 1 week. How surprised were you that they fired Mike McCarthy and are sitting in this spot with Aaron Rodgers and those guys?
Yeah, so this might sound funny, but I was surprised. At the same time, I wasn't surprised.
Yeah.
Because, you know, you just felt that this was coming. Every week, Aaron Rodgers looked frustrated on the field, off the field. It just didn't seem like it was working out. And when you paid him, you know, the big bucks, you knew it was either him or the head coach, and they're not going to let Aaron Rodgers go. So I was surprised that they did it at that time, but you knew it was going to happen at the end of the season or eventually. So why not do it? And, you know, and like any team, I think any team after they lose their head coach, they're going to come out with a little more fire, you know, a little more flair, and I think that's what happened here. So it was definitely surprising to see him do it at the season, but at the same time, you knew it was going to happen.
Yeah, I agree with that. Adam, what do you think? Let's say Joe Philbin comes in here and the Packers go on a winning streak to end the year. What do you think the chances are that Green Bay goes with Joe Philbin as their head coach?
I still think they're going to be interviewing other guys in the offseason, even if they go on a run.
Yeah.
Not to say that he couldn't ultimately end up as the head coach, but I don't think they're going to be satisfied with Joe Philbin even if he does well in the last few weeks.
Yeah.
There's too many guys out there that are, you know, they're capable and qualified and to not, you know, go out and do your due diligence at least.
Yeah. You got names that like Bruce Arians, but I think Bruce Arians is more interested in the Browns job. Tito, who do you think's the more attractive coaching job right now? Let's say you want to be a head coach in the NFL. Would you rather coach the Cleveland Browns or the Green Bay Packers?
Wow, that's you know, I've actually thought about this. The Browns. I'm going to have to say the Browns, because the Browns, I think, are going to have more of an upside in the years to come. Aaron Rodgers, he's getting old, and you know, he might have a few more good years left, but Baker Mayfield has his whole career ahead of him. They have Nick Chubb in the back field there, who's been playing pretty good. Jarvis Landry's getting better on the Browns, so I would have to go with the Browns. And as crazy as it sounds, the Browns are sort of in the wild card contention there. They've been playing good as of late and winning a few games here, and so I think the Browns are actually a team that I would pick over the Packers.
Yeah, and they're surprisingly competitive. They've been kind of fun to watch. Adam, the Falcons dropped their fifth straight game and clinch a losing record for the first time since 2014. Going into the offseason, do you think a new offensive coordinator is going to fix the issues in Atlanta, or would you consider a head coaching change, or what do you think needs to happen for the Falcons to get back winning?
That's tough. I think it's more really their defense. They move the ball quite pretty good still, but they can't seem to close it out. I don't know if the offensive coordinator is going to change that. It just seems to, like, they just can't stop anyone.
Yeah.
And Matt Ryan is I think he's still playing pretty well. They still got some pretty nice weapons on offense. I think it's more defense. I don't know that a new offensive coordinator is really going to fix that. They're very, very much, I feel, underachieving this year. They should be a much better team.
Yeah. And they've got a decent young defense, so hopefully they can come into their own. And maybe they're one, like, star name on defense away from being better. They were injury hit this year. Two stats on the Falcons here. Matt Ryan passes Peyton Manning for the most passing yards through 11 seasons in NFL history at 45,000. Wait. Most passing yards. 45,000. That's crazy. And then Julio Jones catches 8 for 106 yards and 2 touchdowns, and he's the only player in NFL history to record 5 straight seasons of 1,400 receiving yards. The Packers have a big game coming up at the Bears in Week 15. Let's see here. Tito, what do you think on the Falcons? Do you think that they should get a new head coach, or do you think it's the defense? What do you think the problems are?
I think the problem is they just need some consistency. They've had a turnover right in their offensive coordinator the last 2 years. This is Steve Sarkisian's first year with the team. Last year they had Kyle Shanahan, and so I think they need to keep it as is and just get some consistency behind Matt Ryan. The offense, they have good players. They have good playmakers. They have good running backs. They had some injuries to them, but they still have Julio Jones. They still have a lot of playmakers there, and Mohamed Sanu, who can do a lot of things. So I think they just need some consistency there and just, get some reps behind Matt Ryan with this offensive coordinator. I think they'll be okay. I think they just had some bad luck.
Yeah.
This year. They had some, bounces not go their way for whatever reason. And so I think if they get another year with Steve Sarkisian under his belt, I think they'll be good next year. But it's very surprising to see them go, 4-9 and having a losing record, absolutely.
Yeah, it's weird how the Falcons will just do that sometimes. If you remember that one year where they had Tony Gonzalez and were supposed to be a Super Bowl contender, and they go like 4-12. Sometimes the Falcons are just weird like that.
Yeah, and it happens to Matt Ryan. I mean, sometimes he looks elite, and other times it looks like he's Joe Flacco back there.
Yeah.
he's just had an up and down year, and I think if they can get, like I said, more consistency without having a turnover of their offensive coordinators, I think they'll be okay. I think they'll be back on track next year.
Yeah, I agree with that. Let's go to Panthers at Browns, where the Browns defeat the Panthers 26-20 in First Energy Stadium, sending the Packers to their fifth straight loss. Now, Tito, in a couple, probably 5 weeks ago, the Panthers were 6-2, and I was saying that Cam Newton should be in the MVP talks. And they get blown out by the Steelers, and ever since then, they haven't won. 5 straight losses. They go from 6-2 to 6-7. What the hell is happening with these Panthers?
Yeah, that's a great question. I don't know if Cam Newton is hurt, but he hasn't been throwing the ball as well as he should be.
Yeah.
And I think it was last week where they had to bring in the backup quarterback to throw the Hail Mary. And Cam Newton should be able to throw that ball, 60, 70 yards down the field. So it was surprising to see them do that. So I don't know if he's injured, if he lost some confidence, or what it may be. But, yeah, Cam Newton has just been playing – he hasn't been playing great. And it's surprising to see him lose because Christian McCaffrey has been playing out of his mind.
Yeah.
And for them to not be feeding him more or giving him more short passes, I'm not sure why they're doing that. Like, for this last game, he only had 16 carries. They should be giving him the ball, I think, at least 25, even 30 times. Cam Newton threw the ball 42 times, and that's just way too much. Especially especially against, you know, the Browns, who are not a great team yet. You would think that they would have came out and won this game, and they've had some bad losses.
Yeah, they have.
Riverboat Ron has been too aggressive, you know, going for it for 2 points when they get touchdowns. So I don't know what it is, but yeah, they've definitely lost. They've been a surprise team, another surprise team that has just spiraled down completely.
Yeah, absolutely, and hopefully the Panthers, they're going to have a hard time figuring it out this year, but hopefully they get it fixed for next year. Losing Greg Olsen for the season hurts, and they should put I don't know what they need, if it's better weapons around Cam, but he seems to have, you know, a lot of guys, and Christian McCaffrey, I agree, they need to feed him more. Adam, ever since interim head coach Greg Williams took over for Hugh Jackson, he is 3-2 as head coach, and the Browns improved get their fifth win of the year. Cleveland looking pretty good of late. They might not be able to make it into the playoffs this year, but going into next year, this could be a team that a lot of people are talking about.
Yeah, they are definitely playing very well right now. I'm shocked that under Greg Williams, who I think of as a defensive guy, that yeah. Baker Mayfield has been doing so well. His completion percentage, I think this week, was 82%, which is, you know, that's Drew Brees numbers right there. And he's had a couple other games where he's been, I think he had a game where he was 85% completion, 73% completion. The turnovers are down a little bit, although he slipped up against Houston. I can't believe that he's doing so well, that they're playing so much better under Greg Williams. I guess it just kind of shows
how bad.
I don't know. Toxic, or just, I guess they just, maybe they didn't believe in Hugh Jackson, but it seems at least there was a really bad relationship between Baker Mayfield and Hugh Jackson.
Yeah, I agree, and there seem to be some issues just within the coaching staff between the head coach and the OC and the DC. Just too many like big personalities with Hugh and Todd Haley and Greg Williams. Now it just seems to be simplified, so I agree, it is weird that he's having so much success as coach, but good for the Browns. They improved to 4-2-1 at home this year, clinching their first winning season at home since 2007. Let's see here. The Cleveland Browns rookie running back Nick Chubb, to go to your point, Tito, becomes the first Browns running back to score a rushing touchdown in 5 straight games since 1975. And the Browns will look to get another win in Week 15 at the Broncos on Saturday night. So that'll be a hell of a game to watch there. Let's go to the Jets at the Bills, where the Jets get a comeback win 27-23 over the Bills and snap their 6-game losing streak. Josh Allen struggles with turnovers in this game, but shows off his athleticism once again. Tito, a lot of people were talking about Josh Allen's arm coming out of college, but he's showing better athleticism than anyone was talking about.
Right, yeah, especially in this game, there were several times that he was just taking it down the field with his legs. The pocket would collapse, and he was running and gaining good yardage, and so he seems a lot faster than, you know, I think you said people thought, because he's a big man. And so, yeah, it's surprising to see him run around that much. I think this game, he had 101 yards rushing. You know, the lanes were just opened up, and so, yeah, it's surprising to see how athletic he is and how much he's been able to do with his legs.
Yeah, he's drawing Michael Vick comparisons with some people.
Yeah, I think that might be a little far-fetched.
Adam, Sam Darnold gets his first fourth-quarter comeback in the NFL. Are you still buying Sam Darnold? The Jets have had a tough year, but do you still think Sam Darnold's a franchise quarterback and the future for the Jets?
It's still too early to tell. It's still too early to tell with all these guys. You can't. I mean, I personally can never really tell in the first year. Sometimes guys look terrible. Like Jared Goff looked pretty bad his first year. Then he gets a new coach, and
yeah,
you know, he's, you know, great. You know, other guys look really good in their first year. Then they take a step back the second year. So, I mean, I would definitely stick with him. He hasn't shown me a reason to believe that I should give up on him. But, you know, it's too early to tell whether he's going to be that true franchise guy. But he's, I think he's off to a pretty decent start. You know, the guys in the first year are going to throw a lot of interceptions. That's expected. His completion percentage is not that great, but they can improve that with schemes and, you know, getting better, higher percentage passes. And once he gets more comfortable playing in the NFL, you know, that will all come. So,
yeah.
The jury's still out, but I think he's off to a decent start.
Yeah, and I think the writing's on the wall that Todd Bowles is going to be fired after this year. But for the Jets, they should go and get like a good offensive mind to help Sam Darnold out, help make life easier on him. Get a guy like maybe Eric Bieniemy from the Chiefs, or one of these offensive coordinators, maybe DeFilippo, but who knows on DeFilippo. But yeah, make the game easier around Sam Darnold. Good news for the Bills: undrafted rookie wide receiver Robert Foster is stepping up in place of released wide receiver Kelvin Benjamin. 7 catches for 140 yards. And the Jets will look to start a winning streak in week 15 against the Texans on Saturday. And let's go to the Miami Miracle, where the Dolphins shocked the Patriots on the final play at Hard Rock Stadium, beating them 34-33. And with 16 seconds left on the clock, the Dolphins called for a short pass, followed by multiple laterals, ending in a Kenyon Drake touchdown, with Rob Gronkowski, of all people, playing safety on the play. He slipped, got beat for a touchdown. Head coach Bill Belichick was asked about the decision, and a lot of people are saying Devin McCourty should have been out there on that final play. Gronk is usually only in there on Hail Mary attempts, so he can bat the ball down. But, I mean, I don't see Tannehill throwing for 70 yards on this play. Tito, were you surprised that Gronk was in the game, and do you think that's why they blew this game at the end?
Yeah, I was very surprised that you know, Rob was back there. Like you mentioned, Tannehill's not going to throw 70 yards, and Brock Osweiler isn't either. So that was very surprising. I would have definitely gone with Devin McCourty back there. Was that the reason they blew the game? I don't know. They had some missed, even in that miracle play, they had some missed tackles. Mm-hmm. You know, they could have guided some of the other receivers down, and they just didn't. So I wouldn't necessarily blame it on that, but yeah, it's very surprising too that they had Gronkowski back there. He should not have been in the game at that point. I can't believe that Bill Belichick thought that they were actually going to throw a Hail Mary at that time. So it was definitely surprising.
Yeah, even if you throw it down to like the 10 or 20, I feel like Gronk is a liability to get beat if they do catch it. Do you agree with that, Adam? Do you think that's a weird decision by Bill Belichick?
It was unnecessary for him to be in there. I don't think it's the reason that they. I mean, that play should have never even got to that point.
Yeah.
So there was many breakdowns before he got to that point. So were they going to throw Hail Mary? No, but I really don't think having him in there was a mistake per se. It just wasn't necessary.
No, that's a good point. They only lost by 1 point. Tell me about this. At the end of the first half, the Patriots come down and are in position to at least get 3, if not a touchdown, before the half. And Tom Brady, not knowing that they didn't have any timeouts, takes a sack, and the clock runs out before halftime. What do you make? I mean, that's not usually a Tom Brady-type play. What do you think on that, Adam?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know what the reason was. You know, I think at this point he's kind of earned the benefit of the doubt that either, you know, something was going on, because he's not a guy that you would ever expect for them to not be, you know, aware of the game situation. So, I don't know what it was, if he just couldn't get the ball out, or I actually didn't see the play. So I can't really, you know, I can't really speak to it too much, but
yeah.
But, you know, at this point in his career, you know, he's especially, you know, the Patriots in general, in particular Tom Brady, they're always situationally aware. So I have to give him the benefit of the doubt that there was something that prevented him from.
Yeah, I have a theory here, and tell me what you guys think of this. I think that when these teams go to Miami, you go on a road game to go play in Miami, I think that these players are, I don't know what it is, it looked like the Patriots, head coach and quarterback, were out of sync a little bit and not thinking right in this game. And I think it's because they go down to Miami and it's nice weather and it's a great time and they're just partying. And then they're a little bit out of it come game day on Sunday. You saw the Bears go to Miami and blow a game. You see the Patriots consistently blow games in Miami. Tom Brady's career record at the Dolphins is 7-10. Tito, do you think there's something to that?
Yeah, I think there is. I think, you know, I don't know if it's necessarily the party or people, you know, they see the Miami Dolphins and they're like, okay, they're not that great of a team. We don't need to take it that seriously. They play down to the competition, right? And so I do think that there is something to that, that they go down to Miami and they just don't take it as seriously as they should. And you know, and beyond that, the Tom Brady play, you know, Gostkowski missed a few. He missed a field goal. He missed an extra point. They left a few points on the board. So, you know, this game should not have been this close. They shouldn't have needed to come down to the last play. But I do think there is something to that theory that they go down to Miami and they just
get distracted or something.
They should.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, and nice to see a big game for ex-Patriot, now Dolphin running back Brandon Bolden, who on two carries goes for 60 yards and two touchdowns against his former team. And the Dolphins' hero, running back Kenyon Drake, who scored the game-winning touchdown, said after the game, quote, "When I met Coach Gase, he told me, we drafted you to help beat the New England Patriots," end quote. Off to a good start, I would say. Let's see here. Miami veteran running back Frank Gore combines for 116 yards and passes LaDainian Tomlinson for fifth most scrimmage yards all time, trailing only Marshall Faulk, Walter Payton, Emmett Smith, and Jerry Rice. Another home Miami stat is Ryan Tannehill has now won 9 straight home starts dating back to 2016. And the Dolphins will look to stay alive in the playoff hunt in Week 15 at the Vikings. Adam, are you surprised Frank Gore is still doing it? Moving up the ranks?
Yeah, especially for running back. You know, they just usually lose life. You know, a little after 30 or so. And how old is he, 34?
Yeah, like I think he's 34.
Yeah, 35, actually.
Wow.
So it's definitely surprising that he's still doing it. I guess that's just a testament to, you know, him keeping his body, you know, in really good shape.
Yeah. Yep, gonna be a bigger fan of Frank Gore. Let's go to the Saints at the Bucks, where the Saints go into Raymond James Stadium and come back in the second half to win 28-14 and clinch their second straight NFC South title. The Saints trailed 14-3 at halftime but rallied on offense and defense and held Tampa Bay's number one ranked offense to just 81 second half yards. Tito, the Saints were hitting on all cylinders and then they played the Cowboys and have looked a little shaky since then. Do you still see the Saints? Do you think they're one of the favorites in the NFC and could be in the Super Bowl?
Yeah, I still think they should be one of the favorites. Drew Brees has been playing great. He's had a really good year, you know, besides the Cowboys game. And their running backs, you know, that two-headed monster with Ingram and Alvin Kamara, who can do it all.
Mm-hmm.
And Michael Thomas this year has really stepped up as a number one receiver. I think they still have the weapons and they have the team necessary to still make a nice run to the Super Bowl this year. So I would still say they should be considered a favorite to make it out of the NFC.
Yeah, I would agree. Them and the Rams are two of the highest flying offenses, and they have a decent defense as well. Adam, are you concerned at all about the Saints after the past 2 weeks, or do you think they'll start hitting their stride come January?
I was initially concerned, but as I was thinking about it more, you know, when they lost to Dallas, it was that, you know, road team going on the road on Thursday night.
Yep.
And that probably can explain the kind of they just didn't really show up in Dallas. Then you have the game against the Bucks, where I think division teams always tend to play each other tough.
Yeah.
They're so familiar with each other. They know what you're going to do. They've seen you a bunch of times before, you know, especially the coaches. They've been there for a little while. And in this case, I don't know if the Bucks coach hasn't really seen them that much, but some of the players may be a little more familiar. So I think the division game and then the Thursday night road game can kind of explain the last 2 weeks for the Falcons, and we'll see what they do next week. Now they have to play two more, you know, against the Panthers, two division games still. So we'll see how they look in Carolina next week. But I still think they're, you know, 1A and 1B, you know, whatever you want to look at it with the Rams.
Yeah, I think their floor is like 13-3 and probably home field advantage. So not a bad spot to be in if you're a Saints fan. Looking at the other side, the Tampa Bay Bucs, Tito, tell me what you think of this. The Bucs have gone back and forth all year long at quarterback between Fitzpatrick and Jameis Winston. Winston seems to be coming on and playing better as the year is coming to an end. What would you do at quarterback there in Tampa Bay? You think either of these two are the answer?
You know, I used to think Jameis Winston was the answer, but I don't think he is anymore.
Yeah.
You know, and it seems like the coaches don't either. I mean, if you're going to put Fitzpatrick in there, who we know is a journeyman, over Winston, who you thought was your future, and then you bench him, and then, you know, you keep him in the turnover, I just don't see how you can bring him back, because you're telling the kid, you know, we're not sure that we trust you, and we're going to go with Fitzpatrick. So I don't think they have the answer there yet at quarterback. Winston seems very inconsistent.
Yeah.
You know, he has some good games today. You know, this game he had 213 yards, but there's other games where he's throwing four picks, you know, a game. So he's just had a very inconsistent year. And I just don't know how you can bring him back, especially it's a contract year for him. You can't give him a big contract. So I think he's probably going to be a quarterback that will hit the free agent market. And I think they're going to probably have to find another quarterback in the draft or through free agency.
Yeah, we know with these new contracts, they always end up being the highest paid player. Can you imagine the Bucks giving Jameis Winston the highest paid guaranteed money in the league?
Right, that'd be a crazy proposition that I don't think you could pass by anybody.
Yeah. Yeah, we'll see what Tampa Bay does. They'll probably be making a coaching change as well, so we'll see what's up for Tampa Bay. Let's go to the Giants at the Redskins. With the Giants go into FedEx Field and rough up Washington 40-16, their fourth win in the past five games. Rookie running back Saquon Barkley leads the way with 197 combined yards and a touchdown, surpasses 1,000 yards on the season. Barkley gashed Washington for 12 yards a carry and becomes the first Giant rookie to reach 1,000 yards and scores a Giants rookie record 13th touchdown. Tito, how impressed are you with Saquon Barkley in his rookie season?
Yeah, he's been very impressive. I honestly didn't expect him to come out and perform this well, especially with that offensive line that he has in New York.
Yeah.
They can't protect very well, but it seems like they can, you know, they're pretty good in the run. So I'm surprised that he's been able to do some of the things that he's done. And that also speaks to him and how talented he is and how great of a running back he's going to be. I mean, this is only his rookie season, so he's only going to get better and better. He's going to be a Le'Veon Bell type of player that he'll be able to do it all. And so it's been very impressive to see how good he's been doing it, especially with that offensive line that he's running behind.
Yeah, absolutely. And a lot of people are, you know, saying Eli Manning doesn't have it anymore, and I'm sure a lot of defenses aren't respecting Eli as much as they should. So imagine you get Saquon Barkley behind a quarterback that defenses have to respect. That's a game changer, and I think Saquon Barkley's ceiling is the roof to say, you know, he can be as good as he wants to be in the NFL. Do you agree with that, Adam?
Yeah, he seems like he's going to be a really good player for years to come. I know there was a controversy if he could ever live up to the number two draft pick, given the fact that the quarterbacks have been playing pretty well this year, but
yeah.
As long as he continues on the track he's on, I think the pick is more than justified.
Yeah, and are you surprised Mark Sanchez didn't get the job done in this game? He goes 6 for 14 for 38 yards and two picks, and they ended up going to Josh Johnson.
Am I surprised? I don't think that is the word I would use to describe it. No, I mean, the Redskins are down to their fourth-string quarterback now. Yeah. Alex Smith went out, Colt McCoy went out, and they got brought in Sanchez. Of course, he's Mark Sanchez, so, you know, it's through for under 50% completion percent and threw a couple interceptions, and then they brought in a guy I've never even heard of, and Josh Johnson. So, I mean, I can't really be surprised that they lose to the Giants, who are actually 4-1 in their last five games, albeit their only win against a good team was against the Bears.
Yeah, and Saquon Barkley was carrying them in that game. He's, you know, the Bears have been able to hold down pretty much everybody except for Aaron Rodgers and Saquon Barkley. And I'm not going to mention Brock Osweiler, but that's another story. Josh Johnson gets his first game action since 2013 and his first regular season start, or first pass thrown in a regular season game since 2011. Josh Johnson expected to be the starter next week at Jacksonville, and Giants linebacker Alec Ogletree in this game picks off, gets his fourth interception in his past four games and five on the season. The Giants will look to keep winning in Week 15 against the Titans. Let's go to the Colts at the Texans, where the Colts go into NRG Stadium and end the Texans' nine-game winning streak, 24-21. I picked the Texans in this one, but every winning streak has got to come to an end at some point. And the Texans had a shot even up until the two-minute warning when Jadeveon Clowney jumped off sides and pretty much ended the game there. Tito, what do you think of these two teams? Indy is on fire right now and could be a dangerous wild card team.
Yeah, I'm very surprised by what the Texans have been able to do. I did not think they were going to reel off, what was it, eight straight wins?
Yeah, nine.
Nine straight. That was just very impressive. And so, yeah, both of these teams, Andrew Luck finally has an offensive line that he can trust.
Yep.
He's been playing better. I think the first couple of games he still wasn't very confident in that arm, and now he's been playing good. Now he's slinging it again. They sort of have a few running backs that they can also trust in Marlon Mack and Hines, and so yeah, I'm very surprised by what both these teams are doing. I think the Colts have a little bit of a tough road maybe to get to the AFC wild card game. I don't think they'll be able to catch Houston. I think Houston's going to end up as going 2-1 or 3-0 in their last three games.
Yeah.
So I don't think they'll be able to catch them. But if Andrew Luck, once Andrew Luck gets hot, I mean he's one of the elite passers out there. And with T.Y. Hilton looking again like a top receiver, and Eric Ebron coming out of nowhere.
Yeah.
And having a monster season, they can still, if they can make it to get that AFC wild card spot, they can do a lot of damage definitely in the playoffs.
Yeah, Colts will be dangerous, and Texans as well. Adam, what do you think of the Texans? I think Houston's a team that can go into the playoffs, and they can beat anybody. If they put together the right game and the right game plan, they're good on defense, they're good on offense, they're balanced. Lamar Miller's rushing the ball well. Deshaun Watson's protecting the ball. I think Houston is the type of team that could go into Arrowhead, that could go into Foxborough and get a win in the playoffs. Do you think that could potentially happen?
Yes, of course it could happen. I don't expect it to. I think they would have to put together a pretty good, near perfect game for that to happen, especially going into Arrowhead or Foxborough.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, they've been playing so well. Deshaun Watson is back from the knee injury and looking like himself again. Their defensive players are obviously out of this world with J.J. Watt and Merciless and Clowney.
Yep. Matthew, so, all those guys.
Yeah, Matthew. Yeah, I forgot about him. So they obviously can create havoc in that backfield with any of the quarterbacks. They don't want to see any of those guys in the backfield with them. Watt's definitely having, reemergence as one of the top defensive players in the league this year after, being sidelined by injuries for the last two or three years.
Yeah.
So,
and
yeah, I don't think anyone wants to see them.
Yeah, they'll be dangerous. They're kind of one of those, the sneaky team. Everyone's talking about the Chiefs. Everyone talks about the Patriots. Texans could sneak up on some people. Tito, DeAndre Hopkins reaches 7,000 receiving yards milestone. Second fastest to reach 7,000 yards all time behind Larry Fitzgerald. I think D-Hop is probably the best wide receiver in the game right now. Do you agree with that?
Yeah, he's definitely one of the best wide receivers right now, definitely in the game. And when you think about 7,000 yards and look at the quarterbacks that he's had,
yeah,
you know, before Deshaun Watson got there,
yep,
he had to do it with a ton of quarterbacks that were not that great. And so for him to, you know, get that stat, that's an amazing stat. And, you know, he commands double teams. He opens up the field so much. And you know, he's one of those players that you just throw it up there and you know he's going to go make a play on it. So, yeah, he's definitely one of the top receivers, not the top receiver right now in the NFL.
You're trying to tell me Tom Savage isn't a franchise quarterback?
No, I don't think Tom Savage or, you know, Brock Osweiler or any of those guys were franchise quarterbacks.
Adam, you're going to hate me for this stat, but Colts tight end Eric Ebron sets Colts franchise record for 12th receiving touchdown on the season by a tight end. Man, Luck and Ebron seem to have that chemistry. It's a shame that Ebron and Stafford couldn't get that.
Yeah, screw that guy. You know, I'm actually happy to see that he's doing better in Indianapolis. I definitely wish he would have made that kind of contribution when he was with the Lions, but you know, I don't know what it is. It's not like Stafford threw him bad passes. He just always dropped the ball there in Detroit.
Yeah, it was so
and
weird.
Now he's catching it. So yeah. I can't tell you how many times I saw him drop the ball in the end zone.
Yeah.
In Detroit.
Yeah,
every
time
I saw a guy drop the ball before I even knew it was Ebron, I was like, I bet it's Ebron. And 80% of the time it was.
Yeah, that's not good, but maybe it's just a confidence thing with him, but nice to see him having success now. And the Colts go into a big game in Week 15, a home game against the Dallas Cowboys. That'll be good TV right there. Let's go to the Bengals at the Chargers, with the Chargers outlast Cincy in the StubHub Center 26-21 to keep pace in the AFC West. The Bengals dropped their fifth consecutive loss. They are down to Jeff Driscoll at quarterback and no A.J. Green, so good job for the Chargers, even though it was tougher than maybe it should have been, but nice to see them take care of business. The Chargers are going into a big game tomorrow night at the Kansas City Chiefs. Tito, do you think this Chargers team is good enough to go into Arrowhead and get a win tomorrow night?
I do. I do think they are good enough. I think Philip Rivers is playing out of his mind right now. He's been able to sling it pretty well. And Keenan Allen is a great receiver. He's also going to be up there, you know, this year on top of the list of top best receivers. And, you know, and like you mentioned, the Bengals didn't have Andy Dalton or A.J. Green. And this was one of the games that in years past, you'd be like, oh, the Chargers are going to blow it. They're going to find a way to blow it. And for them to come out with this win and rely on their defense to have to do it, they're definitely improved. I think over from the last years, they definitely improved in winning out the close games that they need to win in order to become a good team. So I do think they can go to Arrowhead. They're going to go to Arrowhead with some confidence, having won a couple of close games for the Steelers and now the Bengals. So I think they're going to go up there and put up a couple of points up there and stay in range and possibly come out with a win next week.
Yeah, I agree with that. And it's amazing to me that when the Chargers, they move from San Diego to L.A. and they're playing in a soccer stadium and they don't have a great home field advantage, and yet they're having one of their best years in recent memory, sitting at 10-3. They seem to have some really good team chemistry and are just playing good football together. Do you agree with that, Adam? And do you think the Chargers can sneak up on Kansas City or make some noise in the playoffs?
I don't expect them to beat Kansas City in the playoffs. They have a shot this week. However, again, I'm going to go back to the Thursday night thing. You know, they're going to Kansas City on Thursday night. I think there's only been two games this season where the road team has won, Well, and I think each time the road team has been, I would say, significantly better, at least at that point in the season, than the home team.
Yeah, and you bring up that stat to go with playing Patrick Mahomes, the tough task.
Yeah, exactly. And I think they're still going to be working some stuff out, trying to get through the Kareem Hunt, so this is going to be a big test for them. So I don't expect the Chargers to win. I definitely think they can make some noise in the playoffs, but I don't think it's going to happen tomorrow.
Yeah, I would be surprised if they got the win tomorrow, but I do think it'll be a hell of a game. I think it'll be like a 3-point game. So it should be some good